Recently, I built a new PC for video editing, and I couldn't be happier with the results. And best of all, it's completely RGB-free. Let's get undone.
Gerald Undone. He's crazy.
What's happening, everybody? I'm Gerald Undone, and welcome to Mickey Mouse Clubhouse. All right, for some disclosure, some of the parts I'm using for this build were supplied by Gigabyte Aorus in an effort to promote their new X570S motherboards, which we'll be focusing on a bit in this video. The other parts, from the other brands, I purchased myself. I did not receive any money from Gigabyte Aorus to make this video, and my thoughts are my own. This video does have a sponsor, though, and that's Storyblox. More about them a little later in the video. The main purpose of this build for me was to see how the 5000 series Ryzen processors compared to my previous 3000 series build for video editing, test out the new X570S motherboards, and to gather some more data on my ongoing experiment with the RTX 3090s for use with DaVinci Resolve. But let's start by going over the hardware I chose, and I'll share some performance results along the way. Okay, so as you can see, the sort of general theme for this build was RGB-free, which is going to make it more difficult to shoot because it's just sort of this black void of no light in there, which is why I have this light suspended up here using one of those new iFootage long arm things, and I've got a little aperture MC here. So we're going to do the best we can. The idea here was that I thought, personally, I'm not huge on RGB inside of computers, and I thought it made it look a little bit more professional, and it was kind of fun to choose parts that don't have RGB. And in previous builds, I was having issues where if you use studio monitors connected to a USB audio interface, which is probably common for video editors, then you can often get ground loops because the USB audio interface doesn't have power to ground to the same source as the studio monitors. Instead, it's bus power through the computer. And then so if your computer makes any kind of weird, you know, EMF interference, that gets amplified and goes through the ground loop issue. And for that, I actually recommend this product. This will be the first one. This is the iFi iDefender. It's a USB dongle that you connect to the computer, and then your audio interface goes in here, and then out of the bottom, you can plug another USB that you can plug into the same power bar, and it solves the ground loop issue. I highly recommend these for any PC that is, you know, sound is important for. Even an RGB-free build like this, this still made a difference to reduce some of the noise a little bit. The case, which I think looks great and also fits the theme, is the Fantex P600S in gray. I love this case. This is the first time I was actually able to build fully in this one, and I'm a big fan. The panels come off and they're sound dampening. So if you want airflow, you can go airflow, but if you want low noise like I prefer, then you can get that option as well. Building in it was a breeze. And one thing I liked about this case, especially with this cooler that I'm using, is that it's tall but shorter this way. With the other case I had, which was a fractal one, they're a little bit shorter but then longer this way, and so the hoses have longer to reach, especially if you orient it all Gamers Nexus style. The last time I did a build on this, there were so many comments about which way you orient your AIO, and there's still so many people that seem to be confused about that. What's great is that with this cooler, which will be the next part that we talk about, this is the Arctic Liquid Freezer 2280. There's a few different versions of this in terms of size. This one is their revision number 4, which is a little bit easier to install than the previous ones that I've used, and overall was a, you know, a better experience. What's interesting though is that when they don't give you the instruction manual, you have to scan a QR code and it brings up the manual. It also brings up a bunch of Gamers Nexus videos on how to install it. So he's made quite an impact that even when you buy that cooler, you see Steve's face there telling you how to install your AIO. Basically, they indicate the important part to be right here between the two hoses. That's kind of your pump line. And if you draw that line across the AIO, you want some part of the reservoir to be above that line. And then ideally the hoses would be below that. Now, there's been some other, you know, arguments since then that maybe it's still okay to have the hoses on top as long as there's still some tank above it. But this way is good, but I've seen other people be like, your thing's upside down. If you watched the Gamers Nexus video and understood it, the idea was that you want to have the air rise to the top, which should be above the pump, which it is in this case. Anyway, this cooler's great. It's RGB-free. It's got a little fan here that, you know, is supposed to help with the VRMs or something. I don't know if it's really doing anything. But the results are great for the money. The performance, the cooling performance for the dollar is outstanding. And I actually really like the aesthetics of it. And I like that it's just a simple, good piece of hardware. And like I said, this part I purchased myself because it's not from Gigabyte Aorus. Same with the iFi Audio Defender. Okay, next up, let's talk power supply. So as you can see down here, we've got the EVGA 1000 watt G5, which I've always been a pretty big fan of the EVGA power supplies, but man, they are expensive right now. This one was, I don't know, $400 or something Canadian, which is a lot more than I expected to be paying for power supplies. I bought this part myself. It worked as great as all the other EVGA ones. Fully modular, easy to install, performs well, eco mode, all that stuff. Love it. Okay, next up, we'll skip the processor because that's the main thing. It's a Ryzen 9 5900X, which I thought was the logical one to compare against because my previous computer is using the Ryzen 9 3900X. So this is the, you know, the 5000 comparable one. But we'll talk more about that, talk about overclocking and all that. Okay, we'll talk about the drive. This is one of the first things that was supplied by Aorus. This is their new Gen 4 7000 series SSD. And you might be able to see it. I'll have to do a pickup shot for this. But so you can kind of see it right there, right above the GPU and below the pump. It's their new 7000 series. The previous one was gold, and this one fits the theme perfectly, so it just happened to work out that way. I ran a Crystal Disk Mark comparison between the previous one and this one, and as the name, I'm assuming the name is involved, 7000 series, but it also had a sequential read of 7000 megabytes per second, where the previous edition got 5000 megabytes per second. So, I mean, I don't know how important that little uptick is. For video editing, it probably doesn't make that big of a difference because I'm limited more by the drives and stuff that I'm using anyway, you know, external drives and direct attached storage. But it definitely, I mean, if I'm to validate it, it definitely measured 7,000 megabytes per second in the sequential reads. So, and it looks great. Installed easy, no complaints. Next up for RAM, a little bit boring of a choice here, but again, I just wanted conservative, good performing RAM for a decent price. Even though RAM really isn't a decent price anymore either. So I got a 64 gig kit of Crucial Ballistics. This is their DDR4 3600 megahertz at CL16, which that was the sweet spot I was targeting with the 3900X. I try to target it again here. And that way I was able to easily get syncing with the fabric and the RAM to both be running like in parity rather than have the RAM clocked higher than the fabric. And I don't think I'm even gonna bother trying to show you the RAM, but it's these two completely black bars right here. Again, probably to do a pickup shot there, but it worked really well. And you know, you never know with RAM compatibility with different motherboards and different processors and stuff, but I can say that in this combination, this RAM was no problem. XMP profile took, everything was just perfectly smooth. So this one I'm saying seems to work well for this combination. Next up, let's talk about the graphics card. We're gonna talk a lot about the graphics card in this video. So this is the RTX 3090. This is the Gigabyte Gaming OC. Now, I went through a few different options of 3090s, you know, testing different things. This one's a good one, I think, for, I'm not gonna say bang for buck because we know what's going on with the GPU market, but in terms of managing heat to performance, to noise, just that whole sort of thing, it doesn't perform quite as well, like a few percent worse than the top of the line ones, but it runs cooler and quieter. So I feel like it's a worthy trade-off. And I also compared it to the Founders Edition as well. I ran a couple benchmarks and I'll put them on the screen here. You can see that compared to the Founders Edition, by the way, thanks to NVIDIA for, I haven't made a video on it yet, but I think I made a story. So follow me on Instagram and Twitter if you haven't already, but NVIDIA sent over a Founders Edition 3090 a couple months ago. And I was comparing that against my 2080 Ti that I ran before, and I've been really loving it. It's made a huge impact on video editing performance. So now just comparing this one to the Founders Edition, it's like a couple percent slower, but I have noticed 2 degrees cooler in its temperature and overall much quieter because the Founders Edition still has that sort of a bit of that blower kind of sound when it speeds up, and this one not so much. So I like this GPU. I've been a fan of the Gigabyte Gaming OCs for several versions now of different GPUs I've used. And best of all, it fits the theme. I still want to do a comparison between a 3090 and a 3080, but I haven't been able to get my hands on a 3080 to compare. I would say it just comes down to VRAM. If whatever project you're working on is, you know, effects intensive, or, you know, maybe you're using really high resolution files and multiple versions of that, you could bring up your task manager and see how much VRAM you're using. If the 10 gigs or whatever comes with 3080 is plenty, then I think that's probably gonna be the better choice for you. If you need more VRAM though, then the 3090 is really, that's the best option, and it's sort of the question's over right then and there. I haven't needed as much VRAM as this provides, but again, it was easier to get one of those than it was a 3080. So I think that's what I would leave it up to, but I'm gonna try and make a video on that in the future. I also just wanna take a minute to stress the reason why, I'm not trying to make this into like a Windows versus Mac debate or whatever, but the reason why I like to build custom PCs for video editing is so that I can use NVIDIA's NVENC encoder in DaVinci Resolve, that exact combination. And I've been trying to stress to people for a while just how powerful that combination is. But obviously, if somebody's more comfortable using macOS or they prefer using Final Cut or something, well, then there's nothing to say about that. You know, use what you're more comfortable with. I think that's more important than the power of a particular combination. But if you're open to trying different things, a PC with DaVinci Resolve and like a powerful NVIDIA graphics card, it is unreal compared to anything else. To give you an idea, these types of YouTube videos that I make, you know, they're like 15, 20 minutes long, I render them out in Resolve using NVENC in like 2.5 minutes. And that's a new benchmark, actually. Okay, two minutes and 55 seconds was my last YouTube video that I rendered on here compared to my previous computer, which also had a 3090 in it, but with the 3900X Ryzen. That one I did it in 3 minutes and 24 seconds. So switching from the 3900X to the 5900X, I shaved about 30 seconds off my export time, which is actually pretty huge when you consider we're going from 3.5 minutes to 3 minutes. Like, that's considerable difference. It's like a 16% improvement. But what's most important about this is just how fast those renders are in the first place. When I was using Premiere Pro a few years ago and, you know, doing CPU renders, it would take me 45, 50 minutes to render out a video. 2 minutes and 55 seconds. It's incredible. For comparison's sake, if you want, my 3900X with the 2080 Ti was 4 minutes and 26 seconds. So each sort of step, I trimmed 30 seconds off. Upgrading to the 3090 GPU, trimmed 30 seconds off. Switching to the new 5900X CPU, 30 more seconds off. Down to a sub 3 minute render now on a YouTube video. And I'll share my exports. A lot of people ask all the time, what are your render settings in? So if you happen to get DaVinci Resolve and you have an NVIDIA GPU, these are my render settings. I'll put a screen grab or something somewhere. I've been using CQP and I've dialed in the numbers that I think give you the quality that's really hard to tell the difference at the best file size balance. And I did probably 50 to 60 different exports and compared them all and came up with these numbers. So there you go. Hopefully that's useful to you. All right, so that kind of covers my experience with the 5900X. 30 seconds faster render. General, you know, multitasking on the computer, I didn't notice a difference between my 3900X and my 5900X. The overclocking experience was different, though, and there is a little bit difference in gaming performance on the CPU. So, you know, we're going to get into the weeds here a little bit. If you don't care about overclocking, you know, you can skip to the next section. Basically, with the 3900X, I did a more typical overclocking. I don't know why I touched this one. With my previous computer, I did a more typical overclocking where I just manually overclocked and set the voltage and made it work, and I had an all-core 4.35 gigahertz. On this one, I've tried the new PBO2 with Curve Optimizer, which is a way of trying to get your single-core performance to clock higher than your multi-core performance and try and find the balance of both worlds there, the best of both worlds. And it was a little bit different at first learning how to do it, but, you know, I was glad I was able to do that because it was fun. I like tweaking with those things and I got better results. My all core performance was higher than on a 3900X. I went from 4.3, 4.35 up to 4.6 all core. I can get a little bit higher than that, but, you know, 4.6 was probably the best sort of safe one. And that allows me to go single core up to 5 gigahertz. So there's a big difference between 4.3 and 5 gigahertz if it, you know, came to gaming or something like that. And I can share some numbers here. I would say the biggest difference here, if we compare all these things now, the GPU and the CPU, my Resolve benchmark through Puget was, it went from 1476 was the score up to 1660. So that's a 12.5% improvement with this combination from the previous combination and much bigger compared to my 2080 Ti. And then on Cinebench R23, I had a 16% improvement in multi-core, going from about 20,000 up to about 23,000. And in single core from 1300 up to 1630. So that was like a 26% bump. That's the biggest difference I've noticed overclocking this way with these new 5900Xs, that now they're presenting sort of the best of both worlds for, you know, gaming single core performance as well as editing multi-core performance or other, you know, editing tasks that require single core. This combination is really good. And again, I was actually running 2 degrees cooler using the same cooler on those two CPUs and those combinations. So compared to the previous generation, this is definitely a better overall performer and I'm happy with it. And the overclocking experience in a sense is easier. It's just, you have to think about it differently. And I think once you have that mental attitude, it kind of makes more sense to, you know, PBO2 with Curve Optimizer versus it just, that conventional way of overclocking is kind of ingrained in my head. So there's a bit of a learning curve there. And maybe I'll put up my BIOS settings so you can see what I actually tweaked on this motherboard to get that overclock. So then the biggest question will be, the X570 versus the X570S, and I have both of them here. What's the difference? The main difference is really just, I want to say the S is for silent. There's no fan. You're not really going to be able to see it, but under here, there's a active cooling solution on the X570s, and on the X570S, it's passive. There's no fan. Now, with a quiet case like this, it's only really on post that you hear it. You turn the computer on and it goes, it's like a whining sound, and then it kind of chills out. I think the earlier versions didn't chill out so well, but now they do. So it's not a huge deal, but if having that fan removed is important to you, this is now removed. So the question is, does it overclock as well? You know, is there any issues? I can say that with these two motherboards, I've tested both the 3900X and the 5900X on both of them, and I was able to get the same clocks. So there's no disadvantage in going fanless with the new one. So I probably just would. There are a couple differences on the ports. So yeah, comparing them now, in my hand here, I have the original. These are both masters, by the way, X570 Master, X570S Master from Aorus. And I'm looking at it now, Wi-Fi is the same. On the top, you've still got your four USB 2.0s. And then here on this row, instead of just the two USB 3.1 Gen 1s, that one of them is also for the BIOS, there's also, you can see here, two more 3.2 Gen 2, whatever, the 10 gig. I'm just going to call them 5 gig and 10 gig from now on. I'm sick of all these different Gen numbers. On the original X570 Master, there was another Ethernet port. There was one for 2.5 gig and one for 1 gig. This one only has a single Ethernet port. So if that's important to you, there's a difference there. And then there's a fan on the non-S and slightly different cosmetics. But again, performance in terms of actual, you know, VRMs and overclocking, that kind of thing, it was identical in my experience. So, you know, rest easy if you were worried about that. By the way, I actually used the Wi-Fi. I normally use those Ethernet ports, but I've actually been using the Wi-Fi and the Wi-Fi antenna that it comes with. And I was getting excellent results. So I was actually quite impressed with that. So the Wi-Fi in this and the Wi-Fi antenna, I give positive marks to. So I think that's pretty much it. I was expecting to have a more of an involved situation to share with you, but it was actually really, really easy. I'm not sure if that's because I was switching from Intel to AMD and, you know, dealing with everything originally, or if maybe, you know, things are just more refined now that we're a few more steps into this whole, you know, Ryzen and X570, like everything's a bit more, you know, matured. But it was so painless. All the parts were more compatible than in previous generations. Everything just worked. Everything worked well. The overclock was easy. Very few quirks that had to be worked out. It was just painless. And the performance numbers were, you know, pretty good. On average here, I'm getting, you know, about 12 to 13% improvement overall. So I wouldn't say that it's worth rushing out to upgrade your 3900X and your, you know, 2080 Ti to this. But if you're somebody who this is your job and you're planning on doing this, you can expect, you know, probably, like I said, a 12 to 15% improvement across the board for most of your applications. But if you're not using, if this is going to be your first build and you're jumping into one of these, you know, NVIDIA graphics cards and also switching over to, you know, a Ryzen 9 from something else, and potentially, like I said, jumping over to Resolve and using NVENC is going to change the game completely for you. I realize that for some people, that's a non-starter because of whatever platform they use or software or whatever. But if you're open to just trying video editing a different way, 2 minutes and 55 second renders. It's craziness. And the timeline is so smooth. I just could never go back. And in the spirit of doing a Linus Tech Tips type segue to the sponsor, something else I could never go back to is using stock footage from any website other than Storyblocks. Have you ever found yourself in a situation where you could really use some footage, but shooting yourself was either budgetarily or logistically unfeasible? Well, Storyblocks has you covered with an impressive collection of stock footage covering a wide range of subjects with unlimited downloads and 4K video. They're also amply supplied with backgrounds, overlays, and After Effects templates, and the interface is easy to use and navigate, and the clips are royalty-free for both personal and commercial use, so you can use them as much as you want, wherever you want. So if you think you can take advantage of a fantastic library of quality stock footage and effects, check out Storyblocks using the link in the description below. Thanks again to Gigabyte Aorus for sending over the Gigabyte and Aorus components. Couldn't have done the build without you, and I'm really happy with how it turned out, and I am loving the performance. But that's going to be it for me. I hope you found this video entertaining, or at least helpful. And if you did, make sure to leave the old thumbs up and consider subscribing if you haven't already. But if you did not find this video helpful or entertaining, try setting the playback speed to 75%. All right. I'm done.